Welcome to the Pursuit of the Perfect Race. I'm Coach Terry Wilson, and with each episode, I bring stories of athletes to you that share their experiences at races in order for you to learn how to have your perfect race. We'll hear stories from athletes of all ages, abilities, and races of all distances. So regardless of where you fit in, there's something in there for you. Thanks for spending some time with me today. Now let the pursuit begin.
Thank you. your first time going into this race, did you have an idea of how you wanted to train?
I have been training for 50, and I had friends who told me, well, training for 100 is pretty much just the same as training for 50. I believe them. I picked an internet training plan. I've been coached for many years, but this happened to be a period of time where I was just like, I'm going to go uncoach and see what happens. And what happened was I picked up a lot of miles and got a lot of endurance, but became very slow. So keep that one in mind about why it's great to have a coach. I just really like running and don't really care about pace until I find out that I'm super slow. But so I just kind of put online for the 50, and I followed that. And then, of course, once the marathon came around, and she would me. As soon as I talking with a coach in Boulder, this woman that I have been going to her strength training class for runners since the beginning of the year, so since January, I think. Her name is Mel Rojas. And I've been talking with her and saying, you know, this fall, I think after I get this run halfway, I think I really want to work on speed and, you know, do some road races, half marathon PR is something I'd like, that kind of thing. So she's like, yeah, I can work together. Let's get in touch after the 50. And so after I got the coin for Leadville, I asked her, can we just start a little earlier, please, because I really don't know what I'm doing. And so she coached me right after the marathon in June through the Leadville Hacker itself. Kind of a combination of my own stuff, and a little something in there too, because I really have to swim, but mostly just lots and lots of running. At a really slow pace until I started working with Mel, and then she started doing some speed work and stuff like that in the last like 6 weeks of the training plan.
Nice. Now, is this kind of training plan a normal build 1, 2, 3 weeks to cover a week of more good warmers and more maintaining? Did you have that one run on days? What's this for?
Yes, so it just started to build up over time. I started just building up the month, so I got pretty quickly to right around 40 miles a week of running. And then over the last part of the spring, it recommended, I think really when like it was something that someone had written based on like 100, because it was like, oh, here's when where you need to run a 50 mile or 50K this day, and then 3 weeks later, let's do the marathon. And of course, Philippe Ramon was it felt like it was written more this way, but maybe it wasn't. Maybe it was just because that's what I was thinking about. But the thing with the key workouts, I think, were an increase in build in a Sunday long run to up to 24 miles on trails, which takes a lot longer than 24 miles on road. And then the following day, running 10 miles. So every Monday I was running 10 miles after a pretty hefty Sunday run. And those Monday runs were the biggest confidence builder for everything that I've been doing this year, because, you know, you get out the door on Monday morning after having run that much the day before, and your legs are tired and feel just like the last thing you want to do is go outside and run, you know, for 2 more hours. And every single one of those runs was really a good run. Like, I had a good pace, I felt good. The only one that didn't go well was the day after the Leadville Marathon. I was supposed to run 10 miles after that, and I hit it great. And I was like, no, this is not going to happen. So, but yeah.
Wow. So, as far as the nutrition side of things, did you have an idea of what kind of nutrition you were having during the race? How much nutrition were you eating during your normal training week?
So, I've had the same nutrition plan for years, and it's just a gel every half hour, and then sports drink intermittent, like every mile, I drink a sip of sports drink. So, it ends up being about just, I think, under 250 calories an hour training on the mile training runs on that. Amazing. So for Leadville, the thing that was so amazing last year was when I was running with them, they gave you ramen in the aid station, not just chicken broth, but ramen, and with the noodles in it. And then potatoes, like boiled potatoes with salt, and things just because they're so delicious in the middle of the night and it's cold outside when I went to bed. And I was just looking so forward to being able to eat those things. So I had my own nutritious stuff with me, but I just really looked forward to being able to eat from the aid stations during this race.
Wow. You know, as far as your training goes, what class did you do that get you to confidence to go into Leadville prepared?
Finishing a 50-mile run was a big boost because I didn't know if I could do that. So it was my first one. It was at the same elevation. The course was different, of course, but I figured if I did not finish that race within the time cut either. So that race had a 14-hour cutoff. And I finished the 60 miles, but I finished it in 14 hours and 8 minutes. So, a little bit slow. But I thought, you know, if I can do and that course is a little bit, they say that that course is tougher than the Leadville 100 course because there's four times that you go up above 4,000 feet. There's some pretty tough climbing in there. So, the idea that I made it without those 15 hours, the cutoff for the first 50 miles is 14 hours. It's like I can make the first 50 miles of the level one and then just turn around and go back and have another couple of hours to spare to get back before the cutoff. And then the first half, they give you 14 hours, the second half, you get 16 if you do it right.
Which I didn't probably get to that. Now, you're training. How many hours a week are you training?
12 to 14 hours a week. Because it was on one big run on weekends. So if you're thinking about a triathlon, you know, you have your big Saturday night run, and then the next day you do like a little run. this time it was a big run and then a little run on the weekends. And then also, I would. Interested in giving up swimming, so I did a lot of swimming as sort of extra cardiovascular, you know, exercise, and also so that I don't need to lose all of my swimming because I didn't want that. So it's okay, I had a piercing of the bag, I can take away from my back a lot, so I couldn't give up swimming.
That makes sense now. I know that you swim a lot, and even after Boulder full last year, you swam the next day.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
I'm pretty sure I have points. But going into this race, if you take a look at what you're doing when you're not racing or training, what are you doing?
Not racing or training. So, other things to go towards training for Leadville. I started getting massages once a week. I have a great place that's right in our office building downtown, so it was really easy to go and useful to get all of that flushed out as we have underneath, which a little bit luxurious, but I don't have any more tech boots yet, so just go to get a massage therapist. So I did that, and then a lot of strength work too. So that was this is a different goal that I'll talk about, but I would like to go and do the Otello race in Sweden, which is a swim run championship. And one day, I know my partner and I will get to go and do that, but we were reading about how to prepare for that because it's this big goal that we have in mind. And one of those things was strength training was really important. So that's how we found the strength class that we started doing in January. And then, supplementing what we were learning in that class, I was also doing a couple days a week of. I had a Pilates class I was taking. I was also doing some strength stuff on my own just to get that endurance, the strength to be able to hike that much because there's a lot of running, but there's also a lot of hiking uphill, a lot of running downhill, and all of those things you need so much strength to do this. So that was definitely a big part of it.
Okay. And you also work full time?
Yes.
What are you for?
I am a technical writer at Wells Fargo.
What does a technical writer mean?
Technical writer writes instructions for other people to follow while they're doing their jobs. So if you're using a manual to work your podcast, maybe a technical writer
will help. Thankfully, there isn't one. There's no way to really do this the right or wrong way. So, we need to hear. So, you're saying that 50 hours a week, you
environment. So, oh yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, it, you can run right out the front door. I'm lucky that I can do that. Swimming, I don't know, so I'm thinking like whenever I was training for Ironman, the bike rides took so much time. It wasn't just, you know, if you have a 6-hour ride, you're not only riding for 6 hours, you're stopping, you're getting food, you have to, you know, bike in the car to take it to wherever you're going to go ride it, all that kind of stuff. So I think a 20-hour week in Ironman training would really be more like 25 once you're doing all the transportation and the preparation before and after you work out, right? But running is just kind of, you just run. So I think in retrospect, I think I've been to a few places that, like, besides just the weekend workout, because weekend workouts, I have specific places I was going to try to train on hills and run on different trails and that kind of thing. But during the week, there's a gym in my office building. I would run on the treadmill there, but I avoid traffic running out of downtown. So sort of trying to just maximize the time that I had on, and then get home in a reasonable hour and be able to hang out and, you know, hang out with Trent and my cat.
Nice. Now, with all of your training, there was also have to use a quarter of the week.
No.
No?
I just know Terry, I don't use my road ID.
Dang. As far as you having sacrifices going into this race, did you make any sacrifices, whether it be water or with the train or anything like that?
You know what? I think my answer is going to be no. And that's sort of a conscious thing. Something I feel like I've learned through the journey to this race was really that life is a bit more important than weather, right? Because I'm definitely in the fast lane, it's like from every single day, the goal, the track, the goal, or whatever it is. And really, it was something cool that I was doing that was fun. But I don't think it consumed me the way that things like this have consumed me before. And maybe that's what it takes to get to the finish line a little less, for it to consume you and to just, you know, be thinking, eating, drinking. So, you know, for the year before it, it's not something that I was going to do at this point in my life, just because there's some other things that I feel like are a bit more important. And of course, Trent's one of them. I started a new job, and it's important to me to be doing well there. So,
makes sense.
Yeah.
As far as the biggest week going into Leadville, between the biggest week and your taper at home, was the taper going into Leadville? Did you taper at all?
I did. I had a 2-week taper.
Okay.
Yeah, kind of funny because the Leadville, so there's a series of races in Leadville. And so it starts in June with the marathon, and you've got the 50-mile weekend, so that there's a mountain bike ride and a run you can do on the same 50-mile course, and that's in July. And then in August, right before the 100-mile run, previous weekend, there's a 100-mile bike ride, which everybody knows the Leadville mountain bike race is very famous. But the day after that, there's a 10K. So I had signed up for the 10K just because we were going to be up there cheering for the mountain bike race anyway. So part of my paper was to race a 10K in Leadville. So on the first 3 miles of the 100-run course, the 10K happened the week before. So and my coach had said, you know, run that one at threshold. Let's see how that goes. And so it was kind of funny because I was like, threshold, you know, I wonder if that's going to be here. And of course, you know, the grand final was going to get so it did not take very long to get up to threshold pace. And that was about a, you know, 10-minute mile running downhill for me. So that was kind of a funny way to kind of get, like, keep the engines going for during the taper. But I mean, I've never raced a 10K in the middle of a taper before.
And with all of your training, are you going off of heart rate or pace or anything like that? What are you going off of?
Heart rate. For most of our heart rate, so on the long runs, that's definitely what I'm using. And then some of the speed work is pace specific. So, you know, when I fail at this particular pace or whatever it is. So, sort of a combination of both, but for the most part, definitely my racing heart rate.
Now, are you using, like, the typical zone training for heart rate, or are you going off of just like a specific number?
I have numbers that I tested with. It's been a few years others, so they might be a little bit different. But it's a good test that I did probably 6 or 7 years ago.
So you just did one test for our exams a long time ago, and you just don't use the numbers?
I am, yes. I had two tests, but they were like a year and a half apart, and the numbers were exactly the same, so it was like, are they just too expensive, and I'm just going to use what I have? I mean, it had to be smarter, maybe, but since I moved to Colorado, which is very different from Texas, where I did the testing, so, yeah.
We went back to Texas AGM. I mean, it is the state of right. So,
of course.
Now, going into this race, the week of, did you have a particular anxiety level of how nervous you might be, or scared, or anything like that?
So, I kind of had a couple things going on. I have, when you do Leadville, you can have a crew, and you can have up to 4 pacers. And I decided I wanted all 4 of those pacers to be my dear friends from Texas. I had friends coming in from out of state, and I was really looking forward to seeing them. I haven't seen them in several months, and so I had 3 girls coming from Texas. And then I had my last pacer was my friend who swims masters with me, but she's also a monster endurance athlete, Ironman, everything. So I was really excited to see my crew and get together and kind of do the girl thing. But like a couple of days, I don't really think I have that much nervousness, really, as far as what am I going to do, because I sort of had for me, it was like a little bit less pressure, because it was my first time. I knew all the stats about this race. There was, 50 to 60 people, 50 to 60% of people who start don't finish, because it's just really hard, right? And there's like every little thing that could go wrong, all these different things. So, I was just thinking, if I had the perfect day, I can finish this leg 100. Like, it'll take a perfect day. I'm fully aware of that. So, I think that took a little bit of the pressure off. It's like, I'm going to see how far I can get. So, I'm not, like, kind of looking out about how is it going to go the way that I might have before, say, I was doing it. And I had my race where I had specific goals, so I wanted to improve a PR or something like that. I didn't have any of that. So, that stress level was pretty low, I would say. But it did, leading up probably the Wednesday before the race, my resting heart rate was really high, and I was like, I think I have sore throat. Like, I don't know, maybe I'm getting sick, whatever. So, I don't know what that was about. Maybe it was all in my head, but I started pumping zinc in vitamin C and didn't feel bad starting the race, but you know, something was happening there.
So, good. As far as your field work goes, are you wearing a certain type of shoes for this race?
Yeah, so, this race, if people say that you can actually run the first 40 miles of it in road shoes, because it's not very technical, road shoes are, I guess, could be a little bit more comfortable than trail shoes. And then, once you get to the point where you're going to go up an overhaul pass, which is at mile 40, you start at a huge climb, and then a big descent, and then you go turn around and do it again. And so for that, I would need my real trail shoes. So I was really used to running in trail shoes. And my trail shoes are they're very grippy, and I'm very confident running up and downhill in these shoes, but they don't have a lot of cushioning. So I thought I really like my hoofins. But I don't want to run those on trails either, because they're a little bit too small, they're a little bit too narrow, so they're not perfect shoes. So, like, maybe a month before the race, I went and bought a pair of Hoka Challengers, which are they're like hybrid road trail shoe. And I got the men's version so that they'd be quite enough for my very big feet. And a couple of training ones, and then I thought these would be the right shoe to wear in the first 40 miles and the last 40 miles. That's definitely something that I have to do, or then I would change. I'd be running in trail shoes. Because if even though road shoes might be good for somebody who is a experienced trail runner, I really am not. And I would have felt more confident and comfortable in my trail shoes at the beginning of the race, but that's a lesson learned, so.
Okay. Now, as far as traveling to the race, did you, when you start traveling to the Leadville, did you take an Airbnb? What did all of that look?
We did. There was a, after pickup started, it was between 7:30 and 9:30 on Friday. The race was on Saturday. And so we, my friend Josie, and I drove up Friday morning early to go to Apple Pickup. And there was a meeting at 11, and sort of the day just sort of went from there. And then I drove from Texas, flew in at like 6:45 in the morning, and rented the car, and drove up to Leadville, and it was really fun. But I think you asked me something. What did you ask me about that? Oh, Airbnb, yes. So Leadville is a crazy cool place. There's no hotels in Leadville. There might be like a very small one, but most people stay in an Airbnb. So we did. We stayed in this really cool cabin that was like you had to drive up this dirt road to get to it and go through like gates to keep the cows in. It was like 20-minute drive. And my neighbor rode up this basically the driveway to this cabin that we stayed in. It was so beautiful, and like the aspen trees were all around it. And, it was a cool place to stay. And I think if I had gotten in earlier, like when everybody else did back in, I think, January when they called the lottery, it might have been better to stay in town, which closer, right, to be able to get more sleep at night the night before the race. But the Airbnb is in June. This is what was available, and it was beautiful, and it was great. So,
So, the night before the race, what kind of pictures are you getting in?
The day before the race, I was basically just eating everything that I could. So I don't know, like normally the idea would be some kind of protein and potatoes of some kind. And I call it that, but the potatoes were french fries. The protein was in a breakfast burrito. I wasn't really careful with nutrition. I'm normally a lot more careful, but I also kind of don't need to be careful. I don't know. For me, it's never really been an issue. So, I didn't do anything really special. I drink a lot of water and drink a lot of sports drink.
Okay. Now, as far as the night before the race, are you trying to get in bed as our time?
Yes, because the race starts at 4 in the morning. And we're going to have to be up at 2:30 to get dressed and get in the car and drive into town for the race. So, I don't think what time we all went to bed. They had flown in from Texas, and they had arrived at 6:45 in the morning here, so they were up early too. So I think all of us we probably went to bed at like 8 o'clock. What was it? Probably no later than 8 o'clock the night before. And it was difficult to sleeping, but it was fine.
So y'all woke up pretty early and then drove up there. Did you have much traffic?
That's great. Lots of
time
on the way back.
That's good. So you get to the start line at what time?
3:48.
Oh, wow.
So I was going to meet Doug at the start line, and we were going to start the race together. And I just remember him, texting me, "Where are you?" And I was like, "Oh, we're still driving into town." And we had friends, teammates who have a house in town, which is right next to the start line, so we were able to park at their house and just kind of run over there really quick. And we really had never arrived at our race with 12 minutes before the race is going to start. So that was fun.
No anxiety, basically.
Not at all.
Well, let's go. You get to the race start. How was the start line? How was the emotions of the start?
Start line is very cool because it's in the dark, and everybody's wearing a headlamp. 750 people lined up to start this race, and you know that one and a half of them are not going to finish. You're sort of looking around like, what's everybody's day going to be like? What's my day going to be like? I found that I was standing with him. He's a super fan of this race, and he's done it. I think this was his fifth race. And he loves it, and it's around, and he was just telling me, "Oh, look, that's so-and-so, this famous ultra-runner," and I don't know if any ultra-runners are really super famous, if they were here at this one. There's lots of people that are bleachers. I mean, it looked like the finish line of an Ironman, like the midnight finish of an Ironman. It looked like that with that many people around, like, watching it go up. and it was in the dark, so like I kind of had that feeling about like that's the familiar feeling, you know, that I have, that I can relate it to is the end of an Ironman. So this is the beginning of this ultra run, which they're just gonna run down a hill off into the dark with a headlamp and 150 people. So it was emotional because it's such an iconic race. And it was just like, oh, but I love you to be standing there to be a part of, you know, this thing that has gone on for 35 years. I felt that I'm really cool to be standing there on a line with all these people.
Wow. So yeah. After the gun goes off, how does the first few miles look for you?
So the first mile is on asphalt. You run out of the town, away from the crowds, and then you turn and you end up on this dirt gravel. It's a road, not a trail, it's just a road. And you went downhill on that for a good, at least 3 miles, because that's what I remember for the 10K. But you just sort of keep running down, and then it gets a little bit rolling. But the coolest thing about it was you start running down the street, and you're with all these people, and they all have headlamps, and so it looks sort of like it was described to me as, you know, like a Chinese dragon dancing in a parade. It looked like that with the lights, and just it was very surreal. Just everyone was really quiet, nobody was talking to each other. It was just footsteps on a gravel road, and these little twinkling lights off into the distance, and just very surreal. Like a Friday night at home, it was just a very different kind of feeling. And I had to have with me, who was sort of every once in a while would tell me, oh, you know, this is the part where, you know, this and that. Like, you know, ran together probably for the first 2 miles. Maybe less than that, but I was very aware of my heart rate, and I was running like 11 and 12 minute miles at that point, and my heart rate was at the same threshold heart rate that I was running at the 10K, and I was like, I'm not going to survive it if I continue this. I'm like, please, you know, go ahead, and I'm going to do this by myself. And he was like, okay, and he ran off with his headlamp into the distance, and never saw him again. But so then after that, I was like, well, here I am by myself out of the dark with my headlamp. Let's see what this day's going to be like.
So, mentally, knowing that you're going to be by yourself for hours and hours on end, how do you prepare mentally for this?
That's a good question. I mean, I guess all of the training runs that I did, I was by myself, kind of out in the woods. In previous races, I had not really been alone because there were always people around, like about the same pace. We kind of leapfrog each other. I ended up chatting with them, like making friends with them. Everybody was kind of running past me, and I ended up very much by myself. Some good long bits in it. Of course, you know, everyone's mind sees the way and like have little conversations and that made it a bit better. I really like running by myself on trails. It's like the most peaceful. I just hear your own footsteps and you look around and it's so beautiful. So that's one thing that was very different. Is I really love trail running because I can look around and see how pretty everything is. The first 2 hours of this race were pitch darkness. There's all this beautiful stuff around me. I know it's there, but I can't see it. And it was kind of weird. I think it took away some of my energy, to be honest. I didn't expect that.
Okay. Now, are you going to use music in this race?
Yes.
Did you?
I did. So after that ran off, I was like, well, I guess I should get my headphones out. I put in one earbud on a running quiet. You know, wasn't really loud or anything, and sort of had it going in my ear.
What kind of music did you listen to?
I had a mixture of really angry, like Rage Against the Machine, sort of stuff like that, and then some really, really hot poppy, like Katy Perry. She wants the kind of Taylor Swift, and she's very inspiring. I went in the 50-mile run that I just put my phone on shuffle and put it on like a workout mix. And I was like, oh, James Taylor. And actually, I worked really well when I got here in the woods. And like, the Hamilton soundtrack is great for running too. So, all that stuff was kind of rolling around.
Wow. So, as far as your mindset and
shoe, and they cover the whole of your shoe rocks next to your foot so that rocks can't creep into your shoes. So it's just like a little funnel that keeps, it's like a feather funnel that keeps rocks out of your shoes. Isn't that amazing?
Wow. So a lot of door, basically.
Basically, yes.
Wow. So you get like 20, this is normally an iconic place in most marathons, but you still have 80 more miles to go. Mm-hmm. How was your best day when you get to 20 mile mark?
I started to go down a little bit before that, so maybe you start to think about during a marathon, mile 16, 17, 18, it starts to get difficult. That's when I was running out a video. It's called the Power Line. It has a name. It's a 4 mile hill that either goes up or down depending on the direction you're going. Well, this was on the way out. It's downhill. It's a pretty steep downhill. And so I was irritated because I wasn't going down it as quickly as I would have liked to. I could see the time sort of ticking away. My feet were hurting. All I wanted was to get off that part of the road. Because I knew when you got to the bottom of it, you'd be on asphalt for a little while, and then you'd run into the next aid station at 23 miles, and I'd see my friends, I'd get to change my shoes, everything would be wonderful. So I got to the bottom of the Power Line Hill, and then turned onto the asphalt road, and then there were these two guys standing there cheering, one had a cowbell, and everyone was like, hey, you've got 3 miles, you've got about 34 minutes to go 3 miles. And I was like, I can do math. I'm not going at a pace where, you know, I'm going to get 3 miles down the road in 34 minutes. Like, that's just not happening today. So I was like, oh, no. And he said, oh, well, it's mostly downhill. You'll be fine. Well, so I was really just about a mile and a half down the road. He was mistaken about the distance, which is great. So I ended up running into the aid station. I had probably right under 10 minutes to spare getting to my aid station at mile 23. And at that point, I sat down in a chair, I changed my shoes, kind of reset a little bit. I had a crew that was very helpful and very, I'm going to say panicky. They wanted to get me out of there as fast as they could because they knew what I was going to have to do for the next time cut. And I really didn't know. So they were like, get up, get out of here. And so that was a really, really quick transition.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you get your shoes on, your foot doctored up and everything, and then you get that back up pretty quick.
Yes.
Are you feeling tired at this point in time?
Yeah. Yes. And also it was raining, so I had started
raining.
Yes, it started raining like maybe really raining probably half an hour before I arrived at that station, and it had been drizzling a little bit, and it was fine. I don't know, when you're moving, you're running, you don't feel cold or anything like that, but it was raining enough to where I needed to have my raincoat on and keep on going, and then the sun came out and it was hot, and it was just the strangest, after that, 1 hour of rain, it just sort of, the sun came out, it was beautiful, it was just like bright skies. And you just sort of were running through this field, looking at all these other people in front of you, you could see them struggling. And that was when I started kind of looking around, all these people are in my same position, where we're chasing a cutoff. And I knew at that point, too, that I had about 6 miles to go to the next checkpoint. And about an hour and 20 minutes to do it, which I could also do that math. That was going to be hard, especially if there was anything, uphill at all. So in my mind, I was thinking, I'm probably going to be late to this checkpoint, but the checkpoint is one of the ones that your crew is not allowed to come to. It's kind of in the middle of the woods. It seemed to me that they might be generous in the time cut there and just let you keep on going to the next one. And of course, an hour later, I ran into that, and all the people that had kind of seen out on the trail with me were just standing around, and, there was some crying, and I sort of just walked up to one of the volunteers who was standing there, and I didn't know what he said, you're there, there's no fanfare, nothing, I walked up and said, so is that it then? And he was like, yeah, you didn't make it, can we call someone for you, I'm like, no, so it was 13 minutes late to that checkpoint. So my official race day was 7 hours and 33 minutes. And it was like, well, my team is in Twin Lakes, which is at the 40-mile point, which is about just over, what is that, 9 miles down the road, right? Went down the trail, and I said, well, can I keep going without my chip? And they were like, yeah, if you want to. Sure, why not? So I gave them my chip and just continued on down the path and figured I'm at least going to get 40 miles a day, even if, you know, they're not official. So
after you left the aid station and they took your chip, how are you doing?
I was disappointed because I really thought that I would be able to make it to 50 miles. Like, I really thought, I had said to people, getting to 50 miles will make me happy. But it wasn't just getting to 50 miles will make me happy. I expected to get to 50 miles. So to not even get, you know, I got to 31 miles, which is, I don't know, it's 31% of the race. through the race. So, and then, you know, the really cool part of the race is going up over the Hope Pass. They have llamas up there that carry the aid station stuff up because it's such a steep climb that, you know, PTVs and things like that can't get up there. So I really wanted to see llamas on top of the mountain. And so just kind of a cool experience. I figured, you know, even if I don't get to turn around and do it in reverse order, I will have done half of it and seen half of it. So, yeah, it's totally not awesome to have gotten cut at 31 miles. That felt like pretty lame. But then at the same time, there were so many people around me who were in the same position that it was like, you know, this is not, they're not unfit people. This is just a hard endeavor. And just, you know, kind of try to, I feel bad for the people who came to pace me because those people, you know, they flew from Texas and they have their weekend, and I promised them they were going to get to run in the dark. Have a great time on this trail with me. And then they didn't get to do that. So I called, and they ended up saying, okay, well, we'll just come and look up the trail and meet you, and then we'll walk back into Twin Lakes and get the car and go back and have some wine. And so one of my friends, she met me about 3 miles into, like, 3 miles up the road. So I walked kind of by myself, and then the three, we went together. But at that point, I think I probably started feeling sorry for myself, and my feet were hurting all back. I was in the last, not the last 3 hours, probably took an hour and a half for us to walk. So it was a long day. It was a long day, you know, even though only 7.5 hours were official.
Wow. Emotionally, but this was hard for you.
Yes, it was. I mean, I'm used to finishing when I start, right? This is the first time I've ever had to worry about time cutoffs. So, you know, there are time cutoffs in Ironman and some other races, but they're usually pretty generous, and I haven't had to worry about them. It's just nice, but, from the marathon, like, I didn't know until during the marathon in June when I was 15. There's like a 15-minute window of the time. Like, I had to rush for a time cut. And I found in June, I was rushing for time cuts at the 50-mile race in July. So to be racing for time cuts at this one was not surprising, but it was still, you know, I wish that I had been able to move a little bit faster. And there's just so much to learn about it. So that's kind of my takeaway. It's just you have to know so much to do what you need to do here. I guess that's just not my takeaway, but I should have really paid more attention to what those times needed to be, and then I'm aware that I was going to have to run at a particular pace to get that to happen. So it's been 5 miles with those kinds of thoughts in my head. This man came along that we had kind of a week probably all day, and he had his technicals with him. He had also been cut at the same point that I was, and he walked up and he said, oh, you know, is this your first time? And I said, yes, and he said he'd done this race 3 times before, and he's never made it past 40 miles. He's 68 years old. And so it's like, I was with my dad out there, right? And he's just jumping the line. He's like, you know, I feel pretty good. I think I'm just going to hike to, you know, to the top of Hope Pass, and I get my son and go, we're going to go hike. And it's just like, when you think about it, he's done this race 3 times and never made it past 40 miles, but he's still out there trying. And it was really hard for me to be like, oh, for me, it's my first time giving 100 miles a try. So there's a lot of introspection. But then Shelly met me on the trail, and we got to chit-chat, have a good time, and that was a lot better.
What was that conversation?
She felt really bad, and she really wanted to cheer me up and make me feel better and distract me. And I just really wanted to be quiet and just sort of look around at the trail and the mountains and stuff. And she had all this food, and she was like, but I was really grateful that, because that was the section of the course that she was supposed to be pacing on the way back. So I said, at least you got to see some of this. I was like, that's better than nothing. And she was like, she was fine. She was not sure that she was all that, but yeah.
I'm not mad about her on this form.
Right? Yeah.
So, looking back on it, do you think you were as prepared as you were that you wanted to go into this? How can I work that? I'll set up this game sometime, so it's fair. Do you feel like you were as prepared as you wanted to be going into this race?
I was as prepared as I could be at this time. So if I did it again next week, I would have so much more knowledge. And I would do a lot of things differently. I think if I did, I was going to do it next year, which I'm not. I'm saying that right now out loud. Anybody's listening, I'm not doing it next year. I'm the training, of course. All kinds of different things would be different. I would practice running up and down hill with poles and, in trail shoes. I did some of that, but not enough of that. So I ended up getting up to Leadville and doing some of the training up there. I think the altitude really changes things a little bit. And the more practice that you can get, now that I've seen the whole course and the description that I've received about the first 40 miles was not as I would describe it, I would say, not that it was necessarily technical, but there's some steep stuff that you have to at least go down. That's not necessarily go up, but just practicing the steepness of running downhill for 4 miles on gravel is not something that my body wants to do. So I need to teach you how to do that and not be afraid when you go down and slow myself down, that kind of thing. And the nutrition was everything was good. We had some learnings about the transition with the team. So, I had this backpack that had water and a couple of bottles in it, and they had little baggies of gel packets and that kind of thing that I was asking them to hand to me. And after the race, one of them was like, why don't you just have 2 backpacks and you just hand me the whole backpack? I was like, well, I'm going to save 3 minutes of fumbling around trying to, stuff like that when you're, I'm not going to be fast. But people are fast at this. I'm realistic. I'm going to be needing to use every second that I have with moving forward and not standing still trying to pack something into a bag. Changing shoes, all those things that you have to be fast about in a transition in an Ironman. There's 10 transitions in this race where you meet somebody and you've got to get stuff from them or change whatever you're going to change, that kind of thing. Get sunscreen, all that stuff. Just being really, really fast about it. And then finding the right shoes. I still don't have that. So, shoes that have cushioning and grip. So, if you have any suggestions. Yeah.
Wow. So, when did you say Trent?
I saw Trent first thing in the morning when we were at the start line. So, he was working late the day before on a Friday. And so, he actually didn't do much to Leadville. And so that morning at 4 o'clock in the morning, he drove out in the middle of the day. So I got to see him for a minute, and that was wonderful. We got separated. I went off to go to the bathroom right before the race, and I thought that he, along with the rest of my people, was right behind me, and he wasn't. And so when I turned around, so I find him again, because it's like, I need to get to him before I start a race. This is normal. He wasn't there, so I started the day in a way that I don't normally start the day, and that kind of within my mind. I didn't see Trent, that's not the way that's supposed to go. So I did, I saw him, I didn't see him. you know what, I'm trying to think about that now. I talked to him on the phone, but I didn't see him. We had put him in charge of driving one of the pacers out to the 50-mile plant. It's really hard to get to that, so they kind of have to leave super early in the day to get out there and be able to park and everything. So I actually didn't see him. I just talked to him on the phone, and he wanted to make sure that I was fine. And once he knew that I was, he continued with he was out there, you know, helping other people. So he continued with that day and didn't see him until later.
So,
yeah.
So, as far as this race goes, do you want to do this race again?
Yes. One day.
So,
I'm not sure.
So, 2020?
Maybe. So, yeah, but they have a few, like, there's a camp that you can go out there and do, which I think would be really cool. I believe it. Yeah, I mean, you go out and a lot of people will enter through the camp. Because if you buy an entry to the camp, you can also buy an entry to the race. It's another race to get into. So if you don't live in Colorado, it's difficult to get into this like 100 because a lot of people want to. There's a few qualifying races. Like there's the Rocky Raccoon in Texas that you can go, and they have a few spots that they'll give away there. But if you don't get into the general lottery, you can get in by signing up for the camp. A couple other races you can do in Colorado, you have a little bit of a better opportunity to get in because you can do the marathon for the 50-mile run and probably secure yourself a roll-down spot or a, like a general entry spot there. But yeah, so I was thinking the camp, even if I didn't do the race next year, it would be cool to do the camp because I think I could learn a lot from that. But yes, I'm definitely one day I would like to try this again. I think that's what happens when you walk out of Leadville. If you have been a pace setter or just a spectator and you see it, it's like crazy. There's no way to really describe, you know, this community of people who've been out here doing this for years, and it's just growing. And you see what people are going through the day and the night, and you see them coming across the finish line. It takes, you know, most people 28 to 30 hours to get across that finish line. And just, we have a really tough, strong, fast teammate who did this race this year. And I don't know if you're going to talk to him next week, maybe. But I had heard a description of him with 2 miles to go from another teammate. So our friend Brian Cox was out here, and he was on that bike, just like running on the road to kind of check on people. He had another person racing. So there's like lots of people out here that I knew, and it was like community. Very cool. But anyway, so Brian was running his bike down the road, and he saw Chris coming up the road with 2 miles to go, and he had his bike getting cold, and his time was just down, and he was, you know, hiking. He's so strong. Like, he's a really strong, tough athlete. And Brian said that, you know, he wrote up to him and said, "Hey, Chris, you know, how's it going?" And he was just like, I'm in pain. Like, and he at first didn't even know, like, who Brian was. And so just the idea that it takes that kind of effort for that much time from somebody who is so tough and strong to get to the end of this race and walk across, run across, whatever, and get across that finish line, it's incredibly inspiring. It's also terrifying. I feel like everybody who came up here this last weekend was like, yeah, maybe that would be it, because I don't know what that's like. So that's something that's very, very cool about it. And also, so at the beginning of the race, the day before, there was a meeting in a high school gym, and, you know, there's a lot of motivational talk there, and it's very, very cool. But one of the things they do is they ask you to stand up if you're the first timer. And in the high school gym, maybe 100 people stood up as first timers. Everybody else who was there has done it before. So it's like, you kind of, I don't know, kind of describe it as an addiction. You know, you're just addicted to this. You're going to do it until you can do it. But people who have already finished it do it again. So, like, it's a very unique event.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, I'm going to transition a little bit. What's next for you?
So, now it's all about swim run. So, my friend Whitey and I are swim run partners in swim run. If you're not familiar with that, it's basically you run to a body of water and then you swim across it and then you run to the next one and swim across that and you don't change your shoes. You run a wetsuit the whole time. There are varying distances just because the the natural terrain of the place that you're racing at, so state parks and stuff like that around here. So Wayne and I are going to be racing sort of around San Juan Islands in Washington State in September. And then we are racing the North Carolina Hanging Rock race in October. All of this is towards getting into Otillo, which is in Sweden. I think it's next week. So definitely you can't do Leadville and then do Otillo. So that's what's on my mind. That's been, like, ever since I heard about that race 4 years ago, when I was at Marshman, somebody told me about that race, and I was like, oh my gosh, I want to do that. That's 10 km of swimming and 40 miles of running across, like, island and the ocean in Sweden. Like, how cool is that? Which I did through a lottery, and the only way to get into the lottery is to do a merit race, or there's a couple of ways, but, so yeah, we're working towards getting into that lottery and getting to that race, hopefully next year. And yeah, it's kind of full throttle towards that, so still no nice to go involved.
So, and maybe a few other races that I don't know about, what races are on your bucket list?
What races on my bucket list? So, I don't know, I mean, I have two letters right at the top of that list. Leadville would have been up there too, so it's like, I guess it's still there. Can I think about that one? I would really like to go back to Norseman again and get a black t-shirt. I've got two white t-shirts from Norseman. So maybe the third time would be a charm, but that's what I do as well. I don't know, Terry, that's a good question. I think that just, like, adventure racing seems like the thing that I really like to do. Just, you know, off the road, and maybe some exterior racing would be, like, I need to learn how to ride a mountain bike first, but,
Wow. So, how can I place
all of you? Well, let me give you, like, my blog. I'm probably going to write it down a little bit. It's really fun there. So, that's one of my Kris Cordova at blogspot.com. Of course, Instagram and Facebook, but yeah, I'm always answering that question. I was like, how can people follow you?
I have one more question for you, and that's, what's your definition of a perfect race?
Definition of a perfect race? So you barely ever have the perfect day, right? Like, I can think of 10 years of racing. I can think very clearly about one perfect day, a couple perfect days, but most of the time it's about being able to roll with whatever the day throws at you. I really think that for perfect to feel good about a day, for a perfect day, it's to feel good, to feel like you gave it everything that you had at every single point in the race, like you didn't lose focus, you just kept moving forward, done everything that you could to get to the finish line as fast as possible. But I feel like if I can walk away knowing that that's true, then I feel good about my day. And you know how you can just, you know, when it's not true. So it's a hard thing to do, but I think that's definitely it.
Well, Kris, thank you so much for coming on and sharing your experience at Leadville. I really enjoyed this. And after you get done with it, what do you say, Ottawa?
Until.
Yes. Well, all right. Well, you know what? Until I love having you back on. And maybe even if you race and going down then, it's been great. And I've enjoyed hearing about this race. It's amazing and very inspiring. Thank you so much for sharing your experience.
Of course, thank you so much for having me on your show.
You're welcome. You have a good day.
Thanks.
Thanks for tuning in today. I hope you were able to learn something from today's episode. If you enjoy the show, please take a minute to leave a review on iTunes or share it with a friend. Be sure to subscribe so you never miss an episode. If you'd like to see pictures from this athlete's race, learn more about who I am, what I'm doing, or be on the show yourself to share your story, check out my website at CoachTerryWilson.com. Until next time, continue the pursuit.